If all fossil fuels and their derivatives, as well as the deforestation of trees for paper and agriculture, are banned from use in order to save the planet and reverse the greenhouse effect, then there is only one known renewable natural resource able to provide the overall majority of our paper, textiles, and food, meet all the world's transportation, home, and industrial energy needs, reduce pollution, rebuild the soil, and clean the atmosphere, all at the same time. Our old standby that did it all before. Cannabis hemp. Marijuana.
Let's all save the planet. Let's all save the world. Let's all make it a better place for every boy and girl. And let's invite the president over for a joint. Maybe then old George will get the point. And it's hemp for victory. Let's all march today. Hemp for victory to save the USA. Hemp for victory, together we all sing. Hemp for victory, let's let our freedom ring. Hemp for victory!
Hear, hear.
Hi everybody, I'm Bill Green. Welcome to today's show, Hemp for Victory. I'd like to start off by sharing with you some of the things that's been happening in our state and some of the things that we believe marijuana legalization and hemp legalization would help solve. The first one being our overcrowded prisons. Sam Lewis did a speech before the legislature and said, time is of the essence. We do not have the beds to manage a safe and secure prison. He has threatened to letting out one prisoner for every prisoner that's put in. So every time we put in a marijuana prisoner, he may be letting out a murderer. We don't know that. So it's very, very scary. The latest incident of inmates safety and even in everybody's safety in the prisons is there was a murder in the Tucson inmate, Joseph Prevey, was murdered. He's in there for a 26-year sentence for drugs and sexual abuse and was found dead in his cell of head wounds. So it's getting pretty scary for the inmates that are in there, and they've got DUIs and driving under the influence and under the influence of drugs in with the same prisoners that are violent criminals, and that is getting scary too. There are currently 16,000 people in prison in Arizona right now, and it's more than doubled from 7,000 since 1984. And Mr. Lewis would like the legislature to approve another $1.17 million for his next year's budget, and the money's just not there. So we have to either let some of the prisoners out, or which we hope we would let out the prisoners that are only using drugs or caught with drugs and to that effect, and eventually legalize marijuana and hemp. Some of these people will never be arrested in the first place. That in itself would save the state a lot of money. The state of California saves $1 billion a year by lowering its criminal activity for marijuana from a felony to an infraction. It's not even a misdemeanor over there for up to like 50 pounds in most counties, and for San Diego County it's up to 100 pounds for a misdemeanor offense. But there's different things happening also. Mr. Lewis is shutting down the shock incarceration program, which we don't know if it's good or bad, to tell you the truth, because shock incarceration decreases the time that people are in prison, and usually they're in there for drugs or something like that, and they're in and out through this program rather quickly. So it can go either way for us on what we do with that. But it also, he seeks private funds to open a 450-bed community-based treatment facility for DUI offenders. Then we think, this is a quote, he says, we think it is time for the state to privatize to allow us to relieve the pressure of the DUI population, Lewis said. I think we were remiss in our duties, that we have not paid attention where we should have, when we should, to serving drug and alcohol addiction. Along with that, also testifying, or will testify, is the county sheriff for Maricopa County, Mr. Agnos. Now, he's saying the population there In the jails, they're actually in violation. Five of the six county jails in Maricopa County are in violation of a federal court order, which said they are not allowed to double bunk. They have been double bunked. They have 5,358 people in jail in Maricopa County, and they only hold 3,600. So we're double bunking and violating a federal mandate by doing this. And and Governor Symington has asked for an emergency session to deal with this. It'll be coming up this week. And he's asked for an additional $1 million to start the design for a new prison right away. Other things that are happening, the Democratic Party is trying to get a national health care in line with people so that they can not have to worry about becoming sick. And the Republicans are saying, well, how are we going to fund it? If you was to legalize marijuana and use that tax along with taxes from alcohol and tobacco, you could probably fund national health care. So all you Democrats, pay attention and listen up on that and keep that in mind. And Mr. Clinton was basically asked a few questions about his previous use of marijuana in the past and finally has come clean. And I have in front of me the New York Times article by Anna Quindlen. And she wrote a good article, and I'm gonna read a couple excerpts out of it because it was pretty good. Here's a suggested response for an elected official of a certain age when asked whether they smoked marijuana. Of course. When the political handlers are putting together position papers in years to come, they should include that appendix, and they that might as well call the rolling papers. Exhibit A may be a way of which Governor Bill Clinton handled the dope issue when it came up this year. He backed, he filed, he clung, and the letter of the question, finally he said, like so many other people as his generation, he did smoke marijuana when young at Oxford when he was a Rhodes Scholar. He then went on to explain, and she notes in here that you should never explain, he said, Mr. Clinton suggested that he smoke dope without inhaling, and it made him look like either a fibber or a dork. Saying you smoke dope without inhaling is the equivalent of drinking beer without swallowing. So that's on a lighter note with him. But she gets into some good stuff here, so I want to read a couple more things off of this. Says, we have a pretty good idea that they're not much bothered by breach of laws that accompanied smoking a joint. So this is pretty good. That means the thinking of society is backing down a little bit. And she says, drug use has become ho-hum too. The written rule for public officials seem to be that they have to say they did it once or twice and that they didn't enjoy it. One of the things that was so surreal about Nancy Reagan in her trim little Adolfo suits cruising around the country to tell kids to just say no was that she didn't have a clue to why so many were saying yes. Instead of insisting that they didn't like it, why not the part of the allure of drugs that there been to make you feel, the allure of drugs has been to make you feel temporarily terrific. That's why people wind up using them to excess, particularly in those lousy lives. In the long shadow of crack and abuse, marijuana smoking has come pretty tame. And the drug issue has become insignificant and become unabashed. Short, sweet, without excuses, Kvaits. Just say yes, she wrote. So that's a pretty good little story about the political party and people coming out publicly and admitting to smoking. I know it's just turned that way in about the last 5 years. Because we've had, even Bruce Babbitt coming out kind of didn't do him any good a few years back. So things are starting to shift. And in fact, one out of every two Americans will have tried marijuana in their lifetimes already. And that numbers keep increasing. So we're going to win the vote some days, and it will be made legal. Also, 17 cities in Europe are pressing the other countries over there to become more liberalized and decriminalize or depenalize drug use and drug users. 17 cities, Frankfurt, Hamburg, Zurich, Amsterdam, Rutenberg, Arnhem, Athens, the suburb of Khalifa, and northern Italian province, and there's others, and they're all coming out, and since Europe is somewhat coming together to form a major coalition over there with the different countries. This is going to be pretty important that all these people are going to be telling them, hey, let's start looking at this a little differently so that we can basically get a handle on the criminal element too at the same time. Okay, I'm going to bring on a couple guests here that's going to talk about some of the things that's happened to them recently and an event that's coming up here in the near future. We're going to get all that out in here. If anybody wants to talk about the subjects that I just brought up, about prison overcrowding, maybe funding the medical insurance for everybody or something by legalizing marijuana, if anyone want to bring up anything like that or talk about anything in particular that has to do with hemp, the hemp food and fiber and paper and all the environmentalists out there that that aren't demanding that the paper be made from hemp, why aren't you? And give us a call and we'll talk about that. And hopefully we'll have a pretty good show here today. All right, on my right here today, we have a couple guests. It is Katrina and Patty, right? And you're from down southern Arizona near Aravaca. Okay, tell me a little bit about your community to start off.
It's a very small community. There's maybe four or five or six basically permanent families that live there, households, I guess that you would call them. Most of us, I feel, want to live out in the hills for peace and quiet, to get closer to nature, to be away from the humdrum of the cities and the pollution from the cities.
What's wrong with your right to be left alone, right?
Right.
Just leave us alone. We ain't hurting anybody out here, right?
That's exactly right.
So I understand you've had a little bit of trouble with invasions of privacy and sort from, because you live so close to the border, I'm sure that's definitely a factor. What's some of the things that are happening in that respect?
We have seen Border Patrol and Forest Service vehicles parked on, there's a couple of spots on the road, the main road, that they can look right down into our community. And we've noticed them sitting there for up to 10, 15 minutes at a time. And one knows that they're watching.
Yeah.
Living out in the hills like that, we don't have working like bathrooms, and we feel like our privacy is really violated in the way that the way that we want to live our lifestyle. We also have helicopters. I would say on an average, every once in a while we'll have a week go by that will be pretty peaceful. But basically we get at least 2 days a week where we get low-flying helicopters. Also,
right into your community,
right over our community, or right,
15,
or right on the edges
sometimes.
Of it. What was the last day? I believe it was Thursday, as a matter of fact, that one came over very, very low over the households.
Right over the households.
Of course, it terrifies the animals too.
What kind of animals do you have down there?
Well, basically just dogs and cats
dogs and cats.
But I noticed that when they were using the range for cattle, they don't have any cattle on there right now. It's public lands that's used for grazing too, and it messes with the cattle too. It'll make the little calves run. If people have chickens, I've seen chickens go against the fence, hurting themselves because they get really freaked out when the helicopters come over
so
low.
What about the kids? Do they?
Children don't like it. The children don't like it either. It's very scary.
They wake up the babies, and just cause it causes bad vibes. Got these jerks flying over your house, wanting to take pictures and check out what you're doing. And sure, the kids pick up on that. You bet.
Yeah, I bet they would. So, tell me a little bit about the May Day celebration that's coming up as well. What's this all geared to?
I think I should let you talk about that.
That's a family reunion that's been happening out there for the last 22 years. And, we've had music and...
And this is like a three-day event?
Well, yeah, basically.
Much, yeah.
People usually just come around the general time of May 1st and stay for a while and kind of get back to nature for a little while,
Yeah, they just camp out and and enjoy the weekend.
Yeah.
It's sort of like a springtime celebration.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Good. I know for a fact that I'll be down there on Saturday. I have another show here on that Sunday, so I'll probably head up back, you know, then. But I'll be down there on Saturday, and I think some of the other people from this area will be down there probably for the whole weekend. So if anybody wants to go down, tell them how to get there. How do they get there?
Well, you take I-19 south towards Nogales.
Okay.
And you pass Green Valley. That's one of the big main things that you'll notice.
Green Valley. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Already, you know.
Go right on past there.
Named it after me, right?
Not so green in Green Valley with all the big cesspools of mining waste.
Yeah.
But anyhow, you go past that, and you hit exit 48, which is Amado Aravaca Road.
Okay.
And you go down into the town of Amado, and right on the main street, they got the frontage road and Aravaca Road, and you go down Aravaca Road, which ends in Aravaca, and then from there on out, it's dirt roads.
Okay, so Aravaca, right after Aravaca, we're going to keep going
after
on that
Amado.
Same road after it turns to dirt?
Oh, after Aravaca?
Yeah.
Yeah, you keep going out on the Ruby Road.
Ruby Road, and
past
that is
Aravaca
a dirt road.
Lake.
And you guys will have signs up or something?
Signs
to help
and probably
from
some
Aravaca
people.
Out?
Yeah.
Okay, good. That'll help me.
Yeah, right.
I'll get there at Vodka. As long as you have signs out there somewhere directing me from there, we'll probably be okay.
Yeah.
That's good. Okay, what kind of events are we planning down there?
Several different bands are going to be playing. No Gumby, Shane Eden and the Amsterdam Jam Band,
right.
Silly Putty, Leah Golden will be there. And we're going to have different speakers. We're going to have a midwife come on and talk about marijuana as medicine, both before and during childbirth.
Oh, cool.
Which I can attest to. I smoked during my labor with my children. And
didn't need no other painkiller, right?
No,
you don't need a toxic
steroid. Well.
Or that spinal dermata or whatever
right,
it is that they do. God, that just sounds dangerous, too.
Yeah.
You know, sticking something down in your spine like that.
Yeah, it's all very traumatic.
I believe the women have been known to be paralyzed, at least for short time spans from that.
Oh, sure.
I know in Oregon that if you use the university hospital for destitute people, financially destitute people, that women in childbirth had to sign a release that they had to use that. That was part of the program for a while. I don't know how it is now.
Yeah.
But women had to let them do the what's called spinal block on them.
Right. My wife wouldn't do that either when we had our daughter 12 years ago. She wouldn't let them do that. So we had natural childbirth too. So it was
it's better.
A lot better.
It's better than
we did
doping
do it in a
up unborn infants right before they come into the world, you know. It does. It slows down their whole thing.
So is there going to be like an open mic for people like myself?
Yeah, there will be open
everybody
mic.
Else to come down and talk about their groups and
organizations and groups are welcome to come and, you know, set up a booth, whatever. It's free, you know. It's a national forest. It's our land. Let's make it an event.
Yeah, sounds real good. I plan on even sending out a little thing that you all sent up in the mail about it out to the people in the newsletter. I am going to try to get the newsletter out early so that they have a little time to prepare for it.
Yeah.
So it should be pretty good. I hope we get a lot of people down there. There's a lot of people showing interest in it up in the Phoenix area, too. So,
All right.
So I hope to get a few people down there. Be a lot of fun, anyway.
Yeah,
really?
It is. It's a great time. It's like a celebration of springtime and, you know, getting together with people who share some of the same ideas.
And the mountains are beautiful, and this year with all the water, it's going to be
raining.
Did you guys notify the Rainbow Family?
Yes, they're notified.
Good, because there's a lot of people in that group that will relate to this as well and may want to come down. Because their newsletter comes out from Tucson, so there may be quite a few Rainbow people down here too.
Yes, there are, and that's a group that we want to start networking with also.
Yeah.
Safety in numbers,
safety
as far
numbers.
As I'm concerned, you know. We're sick of being isolated out
that's
there,
it.
You know. Especially being on the front lines 3 miles away from the border.
Oh, I know.
It's
I
scary.
Know. I'm sure that's part of your problem with the police too.
Yes, it is.
The
it's
fact
a
that
large
you are so
part
close
of the problem.
To the border,
yeah.
Know?
They have all this money that they can spend on just going and tromping around those hills with their 4x4s and stuff. And let me tell you, it's fun, you know, some of the stuff driving around. But when it comes to getting spied on and chased sometimes,
Well, you was talking earlier about some randomly pulling over people just to check them out, or?
Yeah, you know, they make a lot of stops if they see that you have a lot of people in your vehicle, because they also deal with the immigration.
Illegal aliens and stuff.
Yeah, and or if your vehicle seems to be running particularly low, you know, any number of reasons, they'll pull you over, and one guy will get out on the driver's side and go around and start talking to you, and the other guy will be there with his door open, and like there's the wall of the vehicle, and the door is open, and in between he's got his gun trained on the vehicle, you know, in case anything happens.
And this is even vehicles with children in them.
Yeah, I've had it happen with my children and another members of the
community. Did you hear what they did up in Maine about 2 weeks ago? The city of Starks, Maine, it's called. They had a resolution pass through a majority vote in the city to basically send a resolution to the legislature of Maine that they're getting tired of that. They're getting tired of low-flying helicopters, and they want to legalize marijuana, and they put this in a resolution, and it passed in that city. So I think that's kind of cool. Maybe we can do city-by-city resolutions, you know, and
stuff
county like
by
this.
I'm thinking petitioning,
for people who maybe,
you know,
don't live in cities, maybe county by county, because actually the county, you see, we're not in Pima County. We're in
Santa Cruz
County. And from what I understand, Santa Cruz is a poor county anyway. Right. They have a lot of trouble maintaining their different stuff, and yet so much money is funded into it because it's a federal program. Mm-hmm. And so much money is funded into this chase and harassment program of the population.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about your lifestyle down there. Do you guys enjoy living like that?
Oh, yeah, we love it. We use solar energy,
right.
You know. We drink clean water, you know, that actually tastes good.
Yeah.
Come to Tucson, I refuse to drink the water here. Yeah. I just can't handle it.
Yeah.
And,
you get it right out of a spring down there?
Yeah, there's a spring you can dip your water out of, or there's a solar well at the top of the hill. We like to grow vegetables and, you know, try and work towards self-sufficiency. It's hard to claim self-sufficiency because money demands a lot of energy.
Money's a key word to a lot of people, I'll tell you. It's something that... It means a lot to a lot of people. That's all you can say about it. It is the main source of everything to a lot of different people who don't plant their own vegetables and stuff like
that. That's another thing, too, is that gardening is a, what do I want to call it, a very quiet, peaceful occupation to do. And it's something that you can listen to the birds and just get off on your own thought train and enjoy the scenery. But even that's being ruined because between the helicopters and the jet airplanes, because that's another thing too, is they fly the jets over very low. They use the little small communities, private pieces of land with houses, as simulated targets. And the jets will go clear like that really low.
Wow.
Sometimes they're so low that it's really scary. You can see the faces of the pilots.
Well, our friends out there told me, Shirley told me this, that one day she was out there hiking around in the hills, you know, having a good old time. And it's really hilly country, right? So she had a really good view of this hill. And a jet comes over the top of the hill and tips an ocotillo cactus. You know?
You're kidding.
It makes it go all...
Yeah. Whoa, that's low.
That is
awful. Yeah, it's low. And they come over our houses just as low sometimes.
Yeah.
They don't actually tip our houses, but they come very close, you know?
Yeah, it gets a good rumbling, I'll bet.
Yeah, it's loud.
It
they're
just shatters
jets,
your
you know?
Peaceful, quiet attitude.
Which base is that coming from? Is that...
That's from...
Martin Davis, isn't it?
Yeah, Davis Martin.
Davis Martin down here. Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, I know Luke Air Force Base has a lot of land down here too, but I don't think it goes down that far south.
I don't know that.
It might.
I don't know what their actual rights are there. They say that, you can do something about it. You can take down the time and the location and give them a call.
And the description of the plane.
Mm-hmm.
But the more that people complain, the more that we found out that they do it.
What was it? 2 years ago, they had a young guy die out there because they weren't strict enough with these guys about just horsing around. You know, they're all watching Top Gun and thinking they're king of the air.
So there was a plane
death.
Go down.
Yeah, and this young guy, his wife and kids, you know, he died. And why? So they could play their war games out in the hills.
Well, that's the whole thing with Starks, Maine, though. Man, they're getting tired of that. They're afraid somebody, one of the kids, is going to get shot. You know, and people who smoke pot, we're peace-loving people,
Yeah, exactly.
We ain't going to hurt nobody. Just leave us alone. What happened to our right to be left alone, you know? Stay out of our lives. We ain't doing nothing to anybody else.
Seems to me like the Constitution has pretty well lost its whole...
Well, see, I still say we have a constitutional right to use marijuana if we want to use marijuana in the privacy of our own homes.
The Constitution does not mandate prohibition. It does not say anything about controlling the substances that we put in our own bodies. We need to convince
more people that get arrested to challenge it all the way up to Supreme Court. If they lose, then appeal.
Well, how do you get the courts to take it that far? It takes money.
Yeah, that's it. You have to get them to accept it on a constitutional ruling, and it's hard to do. It really is. But see, the thing is, as many people are coming out in favor with it, favor of legalization now, and for all the different reasons, all the different key issues like the environment, like the overcrowded prisons, they're going to have to do something. And what else better can they do than to legalize marijuana? You know, there's
that's right.
You know,
and the overcrowding of the prisons and the whole prison situation is a real sore subject amongst us who have loved ones that are in the prisons right now.
Yeah, this is what has motivated our community to open up Mayday to the public, is the loss of several of our loved ones to the prison system this year.
I call them prisoners of war.
Yes, there's no doubt about it.
My husband was caught with two joints and some hearsay evidence against him. And he's looking at 5 to 30 years. They're trying to pin transportation of 200 to 300 pounds on him, you know, and all sorts of other weird conspiracy charges that are built upon their own paranoia and their own dislike for us out there and their own pathetic search to find something to bust us for.
There's a lot of innocent people, completely innocent people in jail right now because of the mandatory sentencing law.
People are so afraid to fight back
in a lot of cases that they'll plead innocent to a lesser charge and do the time. You know, and they're innocent.
And that's terrible when people can be forced into admitting to things that they didn't even do because they get so terrorized by the tactics of the law enforcement.
Well, they're even advertising the number of arrests that they've done since they started the Maricopa County demand reduction. Do drugs, do time, they call it. It was 15,199 arrests in 3 years for casual drug use in Maricopa County alone.
I can tell you a few facts about the Wilmot Federal Correctional Institution over there where Owen is at. Uh-huh. The prison itself was built for approximately 475 people. One per room. They've got three per room, some four per room. They've turned the TV rooms into rooms for up to 17, 18, you know, 20 people.
When you get that many people in that small of a space,
it creates health hazards.
Yeah, of course. Built for 475 people, the total is 790, and it's rising. They just got 200 new prisoners. And one of the tactics that they use is once they get somebody on a charge, instead of putting him in one place for sure for a year or 2 years, they'll shift him around so they don't have to include him in the counts. So there's a lot of people out there floating that are not even included in these numbers of the overpopulation.
They got people sleeping in the floors. Some of them, man, it's ridiculous. We do have a call. Let's take this call. Alan on line one, are you there?
Yeah, I just wanted to comment. I've had a few experiences with the law about marijuana. One was a long time ago. I was out at Oregon Pipe on a Sunday afternoon, Oregon Pipe National Monument. And I had, like, never been out there or out there once before, but I was just going out on a Sunday afternoon. I lived here in Tucson, and I was watching the sunset. And the sun went behind the hills, so I started driving back to town, and then there was a gap in the hills where I could see the sunset again, so I stopped and watched it. And apparently these Border Patrol guys thought that it was suspicious that I pulled over and stopped a few times, and they started following me and eventually stopped me. And it's like two Border Patrol cars and about six agents. And they were sure I had something in my trunk, you know, like they were sure I was a smuggler, that my trunk was full of dope, or that I had aliens in there or something. I didn't have anything. And they were going, what are you doing down here? I'm saying, well, it's a national park. I decided to see the scenery, you know?
Yeah.
No, what were you really doing out here, you know?
Do you believe that?
And they wound up finding, like, $1.25 of roach pot.
Oh, my God.
And a little homemade pipe. And they're hassling me. Oh, they're going to confiscate my car, and they're going to charge me with a felony and this and that. This is a long time ago. Another time, I wound up pleading no contest to possession of 6.5 grams for personal use.
Yeah.
And they sentenced me to 1.5 years on a felony.
That's crazy.
Spent about half of it in Pima County Jail. A little up in Phoenix getting classified, then about 4 months down in Douglas, minimum security, and as soon as I was there, they were trying to get rid of me, and they wanted to get me out on an early release, and if you're on parole or probation, and they get you for anything, or they frame you or anything, it's like the penalty is unbelievably severe. It's like 20 years or 25
years. Yeah, the mandatory
years.
Sentencing laws are in effect right now are really scary. You're right. They could get you on a repetitive offense, and it's like 25 years for the third arrest, I think it is,
and
for marijuana possession.
They got this private agent, this private company wants to build a 1,000-bed prison out there.
Right.
On Wilmot.
Right.
Another federal one. And... Yeah. You know,
somebody still has
saying,
to pay
oh,
for that.
This is going to be great for the community because we'll generate jobs. But the thing is, once they got a prison, they're going to have to keep it filled up.
Well,
you know, and even if people aren't breaking laws, they're going to need to find criminals to fill it up.
Yeah, you still have to pay for that too. So even though it's privatized, the money's still going to come out of our own pockets.
Oh, yeah, the taxpayers are going to pay for this.
The taxpayers are definitely going to pay for it. There's no doubt about it.
The room and board, and it's like $20,000, $30,000 a year for one prisoner.
That's right.
That's ridiculous. It's such a waste. I mean, it's nonviolent, non-repetitive. The only fortunate thing is that since it was a first offense and it was nonviolent, non-repetitive, even though it was a felony, they restored my civil rights automatically.
Well, that's good.
That's the only... compassionate part about it at all.
Are you
the
doing
thing. The rest of it is just like bullshit. So I wasn't bothering anybody.
Are you doing anything to actively try to change the laws right now?
Well, I'm just speaking out against it. I'm personally.
Well, that's it. Are you writing letters to the editor? Are you writing letters to your congressman or anything like that?
Yeah, I've talked to congressmen about it. The thing is, see, when I got arrested, I tried to get my lawyer to make it a constitutional issue.
Right.
And he was a private attorney, a paid for, you know, he was a paid attorney. And he didn't want to represent me on a constitutional charge because the way they can stack stuff here.
That's going to change pretty soon, though, I think so. I think some of these lawyers... Some of these lawyers are going to want to take this under the constitutional, especially with Europe. Because Europe right now... Because it's violated two constitutions in Europe now, the Switzerland Constitution and the Germany Constitution, because equal protection under the law says that if you're going to allow alcohol and cigarettes be legal with them as devastating as they are,
how can you discriminate
then
against
it
pot?
Is, it, yeah, that's it.
That's
and
not equal protection under the law. And the other is the Ninth Amendment.
The Ninth Amendment, which is
know,
all other...
enumerated rights. They're
that's
not
right.
supposed to deny or disparage them, and that's life, liberty, and the
pursuit of happiness. Exactly.
And smoking pot is a nonviolent pursuit
that's
of happiness.
That's why this country was founded, was for the pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yeah, right.
And you know, anyway, you got any questions, or you're going to go down to the May Day celebration down in Aravaca?
What is the date on that?
What is the date, exact date?
First through third. May 1st through 3rd.
1st through 3rd of May in Aravaca?
Right. You get down to Aravaca, and they'll show you signs from there how to get there.
Wow.
And bring along as many people as you can. There's going to be a lot of live entertainment, live microphones, a lot of fun camping out, and getting back to nature.
Sounds great.
Yeah, we're going to have a real good time down there.
All right.
Okay, I got another caller.
Thanks for the show.
Okay.
Thanks to your guests.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, we have Chris. Are you there, Chris?
Yeah, I'm right here.
All right.
I just wanted to comment on something Alan just said that I thought was very interesting about the new prison that's being built. And I think you need to realize that in actuality what's happening is that just jobs are being created for people like lawyers, judges, police officers, just to increase forces like that in order to fill jails. You're going to have more laws being passed that are going to infringe on our freedoms even more than they already are. And marijuana is just the perfect example of what's already happened.
I agree. I still think if you legalized marijuana, I still feel all the jobs would shift into other areas. You may have some forest industry people out of work that would be doing planting hemp or something to that effect, and there'd be a major shift from one employment source to another employment source, and some of these people may have to retrain in different areas.
I agree with that.
And maybe the police could get back to doing...
Unfortunately.
Yeah, maybe the police could even get back to doing finding real criminals and putting them in jail for real time and letting the rest of us peace-loving people alone. Just give us our privacy, right?
Well, it's just hypocrisy about marijuana.
Oh, it is so.
Running scared for no reason.
It's so hypocritical, the system that they have in place right now, it's ridiculous. It is totally ridiculous. So, any other comments?
Not really. I just wanted to say that, and I may go down to Aravaipa to check out the festival there. It should be pretty interesting.
Good. We hope to see you there. It should be a lot of fun.
That's Aravaca. You don't want to get confused and go to Aravaipa because there's not going to be nothing there.
Yeah, really. It is Aravaca now, not Aravaipa. Aravaipa is a valley or something.
Something
isn't it?
Like that.
Yeah, it is a valley.
This is the city of Aravaca. We're a little bit farther than that even.
Well, I'd more call it a township. It's very, yeah, right. A little
looks like
township.
The little old west side. A Wild West gunslinging town.
Is it? Well, yeah. I've never been there, that's going to be a new experience for me. So.
Yeah.
Do you need a four-wheel drive vehicle to get down there?
Yeah. Yes, you would want a truck. If there's going to be dirt roads, you're going to want to bring, if you plan on staying overnight, bring water and food and adequate, a sweater, some good shoes, because...
Plan on kind of like camping out for the weekend and bring everything you would need on a camp out trip.
All right, sounds good.
Okay.
All right.
And you're going to run generators and stuff for the
generators
music and stuff,
are going to provide the electricity for the bands and stuff.
Cool. There's going to be a lot of partying going on, too?
Well, yeah, you bet.
All right, cool.
We've been partying down there for 22 years. We ain't stopping just because of these assholes.
Here.
Well, you can't let those people infringe on your freedom to have fun, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, they try, that's for sure.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah.
Well, Bill Green, I think you're doing a great job with Normal here in Arizona.
Oh, thank you very much.
Keep up the good work.
I'll try.
All right, thanks a lot for having me on.
Okay.
Later.
Uh-huh, bye-bye. Well, we don't have any more calls right now, so we can talk some more.
Your one comment sure brought a nice picture to mind. I thought, my goodness, wouldn't that be wonderful to pay people for planting marijuana?
Oh, yes. Wouldn't that be great?
I pay your taxes.
Like a dream.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. Well, you used to be able to pay your taxes with
so
it.
Right here,
it used to be legal tender in the 1600s in the United States. You could pay your taxes with marijuana. And we're trying to get that information out, too. We have Tax Marijuana Day coming up here across the state. We're going to have people at post offices on the 15th of April, which is the day that everybody has to write the checks to the federal government. So we're going to be at the post offices that are going to be open late, and we're going to be handing out information like that they didn't know before, that marijuana used to be legal tender and you could pay your taxes with it, and all kinds of information like that, like the state of California saving $1 billion a year by not enforcing a marijuana prohibition law like the state of Arizona is.
Right.
That's a lot of money.
I mean,
it wouldn't be near that much here because we have a far less amount of people than California. But can you imagine? I mean, it's got to be at least in the hundred millions, that we could save just by not enforcing the prohibition.
There's another point I'd like to bring up before we get another caller is that what amazes me is that the government says that one of the biggest reasons that they say that marijuana and these different drugs are illegal is because they're worried about the health of the people that smoke marijuana as a substance. Well, I can't help but think that there are so many dangerous chemicals that are sold through feed stores, that are sold through greenhouse places, nurseries, and things like that. And I want to share two little items of interest that people might find interesting about these really dangerous chemicals with inadequate warnings that shouldn't even be sold over the counter as far as I'm concerned. One of them is your basic rat and gopher poison type things. A couple of people that live out there bought some turkeys, bought four little baby mm-hmm. turkeys. And unknowingly, unthinkingly, they packed them for the ride home. It's a mm-hmm. 45-minute drive home, and they packed them in an empty rat poison box. The people took the turkeys out, put them out of the box, put them into their place. 2 hours later, when they checked on them, they were dead. That's pretty heavy-duty poison to be selling over the counter from a government that says that they're worried about people smoking pot because of the hazards of their health. Yeah. Another one is some kind of fly bait that is sold openly on the market that it says on the label as a warning, do not use the can opener again that you opened this can with. I mean, that's
pretty bad stuff.
That's pretty bad. And anything like that, anything that affects the cells of one living organism is eventually going to work up and
just like all the pesticides and stuff like
right,
that are working
all
on eliminating
like
those
that.
Pests or getting on our food.
And any of these flies that get onto this bait are then eaten by other bugs, mm-hmm. other kind of predators like mm-hmm. ants. Ants will go around
right.
and collect the carcasses. Then you've got the horny toads and the lizards that eat the ants,
yep.
the birds that eat the lizards, and it just works its
goes
way
on
up.
On.
And if this government is so concerned about the health of the population, then shouldn't they work on this kind of a thing and getting
right.
these horrible, dangerous chemicals that get in the water supplies, in the air, contaminate the ground? Shouldn't they work on that and leave each personal thing, and let it be your own decision?
But even the health issue, as far as people smoking marijuana, I don't feel they're just in that claim
either.
Oh,
I don't either.
Usually when a person, it has the exact same carcinogen as a cigarette, exact same carcinogen. They can't say it's 10 times worse or any of that, because it's the exact same thing. The only difference is you take it into your lungs longer and that you smoke it usually without a filter, which a water pipe would even make it more safer, and those are illegal once you use them the first time. So
mm-hmm.
it's another catch-22.
Well,
right,
frankly,
there.
I'm a pot smoker come lately. For about the last 14 years, I've been smoking pot pretty heavy, which is once a day when I can get
yeah.
it, at least once a day, twice a day, three times
see,
a day. I'm almost 50
cancer,
years old. Does it
yeah.
look like it's hurting me?
No,
I'm going to be
all.
50 next month.
Not
so.
At all. When cancer is considered for even a marijuana or for a cigarette smoker, they're talking about 20 pack 2 day a year. Two days a year for 20 years before even instances of cancer would start showing up. A person that smokes marijuana would never smoke that many cigarettes in their entire lifetime.
Well,
so the chances of anyone ever getting cancer from marijuana are very, very slim.
The thing of it is even on the tobacco, I don't believe that it's the tobacco itself that it...
It could be all the stuff that they're putting in it.
Exactly. I've thought
well
of this before
be.
Because they use pesticides and herbicides on the ground that it uses. And in the old days, people who just rolled their cigarettes from basically natural tobacco,
mm-hmm.
you never heard about these
mm-hmm.
cases of emphysema. Another point I want to bring up is that the air that you breathe, even from a city like Tucson, and then you go into cities like Detroit and New York City,
yeah, I've been there.
And you don't have to smoke anything. Just the air does it to you. So
I can
smell it and taste it as soon as I come within the limits of that layer of fog.
I'll bet. Well, we got another call, so let's get it. Okay, Jeff, you're on.
Hello.
How are you?
Yeah, my question is, what kind of support are we getting from tobacco companies, because they will be the ones who will manufacture pre-made legalized marijuana once it becomes so.
Actually, tobacco companies are not helping us whatsoever. From what I understand, they have purchased land in various places to implement it if anybody else gets it implemented for them. They want to make money off of it once it's legalized, I'm sure, just as everybody would, but nobody wants to get on the bandwagon to say that they want it legalized from that group.
Yeah, that's what we need is some support as lobbyists.
I agree. Actually, I don't know if they specifically lobby against us like the alcohol companies do, but the alcohol companies lobby against us because we're a direct competition for the intoxicant market. I mean, right now, alcohol, even though it's spread out between all the different types of alcohol, has a monopoly on the intoxication market because nothing else is allowed legally except alcohol.
And so, prescription drugs for people who can afford to buy prescription drugs.
That you would have to be going to a doctor and get prescription drugs and everything then in that respect.
Exactly.
So that's not really, that doesn't
that's
count
a
as a legal intoxicant. Yeah, but there's a lot of people that even abuse legal substances as
right,
well.
Right, and the thing of it is
that's
the people
doctors
who
write out all those scripts
right.
for people
right.
who are having stress and, oh yeah, take a Valium,
yeah.
you'll feel better. And
yeah, really.
Years later,
the Jamaican studies themselves come out and they say it'll cause less wrinkles if you smoke marijuana on a daily basis and you'll live longer. They don't talk about those kind of studies on the air on regular TV
yeah.
and stuff like that. Do you have any other comments, Jeff?
No, I just wanted to say that I'm one of the statistics you spoke about earlier. I was arrested last April for smoking one joint at a rock concert, so.
Yeah, we're actually, it gives me an opportunity to bring up something else that Normal is organizing in the state. I don't know if you've been up to Maricopa County and the concerts up there, but that's what they're doing. They're arresting people out in the parking lots for smoking marijuana. It's even going to the point where they'll offer to sell you a joint, and if you buy it, they'll arrest you.
Yeah,
so it's getting really bad.
Maricopa County is where it happens.
That's where, that's we're going out next week. As a matter of fact, there was a gentleman that was arrested. His name was John Camby. He was arrested for basically identifying a police officer at the Guns N' Roses concert up there. And we're going out. We're calling it the Camby Concert Patrol, and we're getting a group of people to cruise the parking lot at the U2 concert on April 10th. And we're going to try to keep from getting anybody arrested that night. So
I'll be there.
Okay. Well, if you see us in the parking lot, cheer us on, because we're
sure
going to send out press releases and let everybody know we're taking up the offensive
yeah,
on
right
this.
On.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
That's good. That's good.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Yeah, we are. That's going to be a lot of fun, too. So Normal is we're taking an active response to all this stuff. So we're tired of it.
Sick to death of this.
Yeah.
And bringing up alcohol as being the one legal drug that people are able to use and abuse and misuse is that in the February, I believe it was the February National Geographic, they had a couple of very interesting articles. And the one that really got to me was the, what do they call it, the alcohol...
Fetal alcohol syndrome.
Right.
Yeah, for
and they
mothers.
Had pictures, and it was terrible.
Oh, yeah.
And
it was
I have
bad.
Known very many women personally who smoke marijuana regularly. You mm-hmm. don't know from the very moment that you conceive. You're usually like 2 to 3 weeks already mm-hmm. into the process before the woman even realizes
right.
that she's pregnant.
Right.
And the thing of it is that those pictures just made me sick. I have never seen anything like that.
No,
the children that are born from people who smoke marijuana are bright, active, healthy,
there's no doubt about it.
Beautiful children.
The only thing they found that they proved from studying mothers who have smoked marijuana through their pregnancies, you have a smaller birth weight baby. And
my daughter was 9
that
pounds.
Was
9
exactly.
pounds.
Exactly.
Well, maybe it would have been 10, Maybe it's an advantage to smoke it because you don't want too big of a baby at birth. I don't know, it's very possible that could be too. And I don't see nothing wrong with having a smaller baby. Now, if it was too small, then it might be a problem.
No, cigarettes, because of the way they close up your blood vessels.
Yeah.
They also eat out carbohydrates, which the baby needs.
Yeah, cigarettes are probably worse for you than marijuana.
They have been proven
to
actually cause...
And when my wife was pregnant, though, must
Why
be 13 years
munchies?
Ago.
I mean, come on.
Oh, yeah. She couldn't
you
eat
get
nothing.
Pregnant, get the
she couldn't eat absolutely nothing. She was in the hospital 10 days before they found out she was pregnant. That's how bad this was.
Oh,
okay.
Wow.
They wouldn't let her out until she could keep down food. I had to sneak her in a joint in the hospital after 10 days to get her out because she couldn't get out of the hospital because she couldn't keep down solid food. Smoked a joint. An hour later, she ate a burger and fries, and we were gone.
Right.
So that's just the way it works. Okay, I think we have another caller here. I don't know who it is. Hello, do we have a caller?
How many kids did the lady on the left have?
How many kids?
Mm-hmm. I have two children.
Two?
Yeah.
And you were on marijuana when you had them both?
I smoke marijuana regularly, yes, I do.
And your doctor approves of it?
I do not go through the American Miracle Association. I do not believe in the practices that they use in childbirth. I don't know how you feel about this, but I would never want to be strapped to a table during childbirth. I would want the presence of friends and family to help encourage me. Women have been having babies for thousands of years before there were hospitals and doctors, and there are more humane ways of dealing with it.
Let me add that my wife, when she had her baby 12 years ago, told the doctor after she was released from the hospital that she was smoking marijuana, and that's how she got out, and that she was going to continue to smoke marijuana in order to keep up her nutritional necessities for her and the baby. And the doctor did not say either way whether she should quit or continue using. And she did continue using, and my daughter's a very healthy 12-year-old right now.
Oh, yeah, so. My children are both very healthy. My almost 3-year-old talks more than
my daughter don't get sick at all. She don't get mumps. She don't get anything.
Yeah, my kids are healthy and bright.
She don't even get the flu.
And I've seen hundreds of kids, the same thing. You know, their mothers smoked.
Well, we know marijuana is definitely an anti-nauseant, so it's bound to help morning sickness.
Like,
or if in my wife's case, she was like sick constantly.
Also backache, you get backaches, your feet swell up, you know, you get in a bad mood.
Yeah.
It's just, marijuana is not a hard substance. It's a
not
natural,
a hard drug at all. It needs to be totally separated.
Yeah.
It is an herb.
In fact, there's many old medical books that have like poultices and teas made
tinctures.
From marijuana for different backaches, cramps,
right.
Different things like that.
The Queen of England was even recommended by her doctor when she had her period and premenstrual cramps and stuff like that. He prescribed that for the Queen of England to smoke marijuana. And that's documented.
Oh, there's much documented information on the medical uses of marijuana.
Yes. Do you have any other questions, Kim? Is this Kim on, or who is this?
Jane.
Jane? I'm sorry, Jane, I didn't have your name written down up here. Do you have any other comments or questions?
No, that's right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Okay, this is Kim. Hi, Kim.
Hi. I have like a question, and I have a couple of questions. Why do you think it is that local law enforcement and our government, I guess, because I've moved here from two other states, why is it that they are so ferociously trying to put people in jail for smoking pot, and they won't do anything about the people that are smoking crack and ice and all that?
Well, I have an honest belief that they make more money in this state.
They're making too much money on it, that's why.
For confiscations, and they know that the marijuana smokers are usually peace-loving people. We don't fight back. We won't shoot back, and that's a big concern with them.
Yeah, nonviolent.
And we are nonviolent.
Activities.
And a crack smoker may have a tendency to be more violent and be supporting a physical addiction to where they don't want to get arrested and go to jail, so they may be a lot more dangerous to the police officers pursuing them.
Well, here's a good example of how they make more money, and it's proven, although it's not being investigated. This past year, the Tucson DPS confiscated, I believe the number was 13 tons of marijuana.
Yeah.
And they somehow
lost
11 tons of marijuana.
They lost it. That's
right.
Yeah,
up in smoke.
Yeah, right.
Actually, it worked out. We figured out, we did a report for the Phoenix Gazette, and we figured out it was enough for 3 joints for every single citizen of Arizona. Man, woman, and child. So that's a lot of marijuana let on the streets if it's so dangerous, right?
Yeah, exactly.
They just proved to us that it wasn't that dangerous.
Well, they let it back out
right?
on the streets
that's
and
right.
then rearrest the people that they sell it to.
That's right. They arrested 25 people, and they let out that much. Maybe we can get them to go after a couple hundred and just have enough for everybody then.
Yeah, really.
Do you have any other questions? We're running short on time.
Basically, how close are we to getting it legalized? I mean, what percentage of people are in this movement and
okay.
want to get legalized?
We are getting stronger and stronger every day. We are getting on public access TV all across the country with different organizations. I have personally 50 other organizations that I exchange newsletter and information with. Mm-hmm. We have BBS's electronic bulletin boards all across the country and in Arizona. The information is getting out. I think if everybody knew as much information as I have acquired in the last 2 years, it would be legal already.
That's the thing, legalization. It's got to continue or else we're going to get squashed.
Knowledge,
we're just
going to
get squashed.
Knowledge.
All of us
people
smokers.
Are ignorant. That's the problem. They're ignorant, and there's nothing wrong with being ignorant as long as you can learn.
And the government and the newspapers and all of those things are trying to keep the masses ignorant, too.
That's
because
true.
This is a game that the government plays. It does make them big bucks.
That's true.
Well, myself as a personal citizen, how can I get involved?
Just join Normal. Join
Come
the Tucson
down to Mayday.
Hoopa. Come down Mayday to
join
these folks' event
Normal.
Here. Join Freedom Fighters. All kinds of activist groups all across the country.
Speak up to people.
Speak up. Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks for calling. I'd like to thank Patty and Katrina for coming on the show today.
Thank you.
And everybody out there watching, we hope you join us again the next time we're on. And goodbye and have a good, wonderful, hempy day. Right?
Let's all save the world. Let's all make it a better place for every boy and girl. And let's invite the president over for a joint. Maybe then old George will get the point. And it's hemp for victory. Let's all march today. Hemp for victory to save the USA. Hemp for victory. Together we all sing. Hemp for victory. Let's let our freedom ring. 460,000 were arrested just last year while politicians snort cocaine and laugh and drink their beer. I say let's vote them out of office. Don't you know you have a voice? And we are all Americans and we still have freedom of choice. And it's hemp for victory. Let's all march today. Hemp for victory to save the USA. Hemp for victory, together we all sing. Hemp for victory, let's let our freedom ring. Or better yet, let's put them on a jet and send them overseas. 'Cause they want to save Russia and they sure don't hear our pleas. And think of all the money that the taxpayers would save. And the homeless would be working as the hemp fields proudly wave. And it's hemp for victory. Let's all march today. Hemp for victory to save the USA. Hemp for victory. Together we all sing. Hemp for victory. Let's let our freedom ring. Now some of you are laughing, but I'll tell you this ain't no joke. And hemp has many uses than just its wonderful smoke. And the government has lied to you, 'cause hemp has many cures. And when it goes back on the market, that bush will burn for sure. And it's hemp for victory. Let's all march today. Hemp for victory to save the USA. Hemp for victory, together we all sing. Hemp for victory, let's let our freedom ring. Hemp for victory.
Hear, hear.
Listen to the trees. They're trying to tell us something about what our polluted air is doing to them and to us. Fortunately, there's an answer. It can help save the air and everything that lives in it. Listen to the trees, because air pollution is a problem hanging over all of us.